All right. We're now
Who?
live. Everybody can, the one person watching can see us.
Hello, Twitch.
So, how was everybody's vacation, holidays, and whatnot?
Pretty good, except for the part where I got sick at the end.
Mine's going well.
Good. Are you still out of town or are you back in town now?
I'm in town.
Okay.
Same.
Twitch, are you here?
Yep.
Excellent. Wicco, are you here?
Yep.
All right. So I will give the recap since it's been a short minute since we played. So y'all were exploring the Savage Frontier, working on various little missions that the NPCs sent you on, that you drove whenever the town of Tribor was invaded by giants. Excuse me. They eventually led you to the town of Silvery Moon to investigate a wagon full of treasures. Upon finding said wagon, a great battle commenced. One of your companions fell and moved on. Only to find out that the vast treasure ended up just being some potions and whatnot. If I remember correctly, I think Raylan was gonna go back and burn the place down or something, and Wendell stopped him, or Wendell was gonna burn it down and Raylan stopped
It
him.
wouldn't
So
have been me because I was not there.
somebody was gonna burn down something and somebody stopped them. And then I believe everybody went back to the bar to drown their sorrows. So 1 second here. I miss anything? Does that sound about right for everybody?
Yeah.
Excellent.
I was not here, so I don't know.
This little tavern has a. Okay, it was something that. Right, so yeah, you all sit around the table. Drinking your sorrows away, mourning the passing of Grundar. Mapping out y'all's next journey. So Wicco and or Ishii and Winston and Raylan, what are y'all's thoughts on where you would like to go next?
Wasn't there some other quests around the area?
There's a little map for you. Here are the notes with you.
Hang on, I'm going back through my notes here and
I only show one quest as completed. Dars, Helgar.
There you go, there's all the different quests there. Yeah,
I was gonna say, I think we the last time we had successfully delivered the Weevil.
Didn't we do Narth Tezzeren? Didn't we have his wagon with us?
Yeah, we're traveling in his wagon at this point. And we're supposed to be taking that to where? Noinar's Hold.
Yeah, that was back actually, that we passed it.
Yeah, the whole plan was to pass by Noenar's hold, drop off the wagon.
So we did that then.
Yeah, you did that.
Or no, we get to keep the wagon.
That was the guy that was kind of the dick and didn't even say anything to you.
Okay, so we finished that. Oathavir's quest is the one in Silvery Moon, which it sounds like that's the one you guys just did.
I'm looking to see. Yeah, Oathavir's quest is the one we did. That's where he died.
So basically, there's an ancestral keep for Urgula Meltheimer. Northwest of Silvery Moon, what is it called? Zymorvan Hall. He has a giant slayer weapon there. And then Citadel Felbar. We have a letter of recommendation that we're supposed to deliver to the king and queen and or queen in Citadel Felbar. So it seems to me the easiest choice would be to go to Zymorvan Hall and then come back along Silver Moon Pass and make our way up to Citadel Felbar.
Who amongst us can use a giant weapon?
A giant slayer weapon.
Yeah, it's
same question.
It's a normal weapon that just has a properties of giant slayer.
I understand now. I connotated that toward its side.
Actual giant weapon. Like, it's as tall as a house.
It's a giant that you get in that is a weapon.
Right, yes. I mean, isn't that what we were all thinking?
Okay. I mean, I'm down with a sequential, you know, distance plan. There's no reason to backtrack if you don't have to more than necessary.
All right.
So for time's sake, Grundar passed away like today, and we're at the tavern at night. Is that where we're at?
Yep, that is correct. I believe I recall it was early evening when y'all came in, so I would imagine now it's probably 10 to 11 o'clock at night. You've laid your friend to rest by dwarven means. And yeah, y'all are in the tavern now.
So to our knowledge, any of, you know, the dwarven customs or otherwise burial rites that may have been discussed that were important to Grundar, we have executed those. There's no...
Yeah, his corpse, he like rose up and disappeared as a ghost. So, I guess that's it.
Cool. I mean, it sounds like a bed for the night and head toward Zymorvan Hall in the...
Alright.
I imagine our wagon is still well stocked with rations and all that stuff.
Yeah, the wagon, horse and wagons out front, the tavern that y'all are in kind of doubles as an inn and has a stable, so they're taking care of everything. And you've, excuse me, hearing the loss of your friend, they have comped your room for the evening, so y'all got a place to stay and whatnot.
Okay.
I tip like a gold to the barkeep as thank.
So y'all finally turn in for the evening. That night, Winston, your dreams trouble you again. You find yourself once again standing on top of a giant squid that's kind of moving through the water, and it eventually comes to a halt and these giant tentacles come up out of the water around you, and they begin to kind of take the shape of something as you hear Grundar's voice kind of booming from the distance that says that she is coming. And right as these tentacles begin to bear down and take shape of a face, you're kind of jolted awake from your sleep.
You said I was riding the squid or standing on top of the squid while it moved through the water, like it wasn't trying to kill me at that.
Correct. But the, well, okay, I was sitting there hitting shift wondering why my key wasn't going, or my mic wasn't lighting up. But the, you did get the impression that the stuff that came up out of the water around you, that began to barrel down on you definitely had ill intention.
Ooh.
Okay. So now that I'm awake, is it like morning time, or do I need to try to go back to sleep?
No, it's morning time. You suspect that it's probably about 5:36 in the morning.
I'll pack all my stuff and head down and, you know, secure a table and order breakfast and wait for everyone else to.
Oh, good morning.
Morning.
Excuse me. Bourbon tickled a little bit. So as y'all are sitting around enjoying some breakfast, Ishii, have you come downstairs yet, or are you still upstairs?
No, I came downstairs.
Okay, so you're downstairs. You're all sitting around the table mapping out the route to Zymorven Hall when a dwarf walks in wearing some chainmail with a shield slung over his back, and you see him kind of go up to the barkeep, and you hear him talking back and forth a little bit, and the barkeep kind of looks over your direction and points at you, and you see the dwarf nod to him and begin to head your direction.
What does this dwarf look like? I got the shield part.
It's got on a chain shirt and the shield. And a second, let me check on the crest. Leave me hanging, Trix.
As I notice he or she or whatever, the dwarf starts approaching us, I kind of let Ishii and Raylan. And Wendell. Oh. I guess it's Wendell's here too. I just don't see him in game.
Yeah, Wendell's here. He's a little shorter. He doesn't have his booster seat up, being a halfling and all. Or a gnome, I'm sorry.
DM racism.
What could have... Raylan kind of sits back. He's still waiting on his eggs to arrive.
So the eggs do arrive, and the hostess leaves, and the dwarf is meandering about on their way over to you.
All right, so the dwarf looks over at the group and hollers, "Hey, you be the group that be traveling with the famous Grundar from the Grundar's Ale fame?"
Raylan kind of looks down into his plate.
Winston gets teary-eyed, but remains stoic-faced and just kind of nods affirmatively.
continue walking up, put my boot up on the bench or whatever, and goes, Jesus, you guys are a lively crowd. Who died?
The famous Grandar. And I would advise you not speak ill of them.
What? You can't be serious. That's got me all cattywampus. That's got me fixing to want to go whoop a man's ass. You got to be kidding me. Don't. Come on, friend. That's not funny at all.
Raylan kind of looks up and you see his eyes are in the same kind of steely demeanor that he gets when he's talking to somebody that isn't listening. And he says, there's nothing funny about anything that's been said so far today.
Well, I'll be damned. Spend half my life trying to figure out how to be a good brewmaster, and I finally find something that I want to tailor my stuff after, and you're telling me that the man is dead? So, how did it happen?
It's all a bit of a blur. As I look to the people who were actually there to maybe explain it.
Insert really descriptive description of the encounter.
I would say, friend, forgive me. I don't know your name. I don't know your aspirations. I appreciate your ambitions. Grandar would have too, but we just lost our friend yesterday. Put him to rest, as the dwarves say. Can you let us process? Maybe talk to us later.
Ah, come now, friend. Be upbeat about it. This is not any reason to be bad or upset. It's not what Grundar would want. Trust me when I tell you, I drank some of his ale, and even though the man may be gone on, or should I say dwarf, has gone on, his ale is the best that I've ever tasted, and I can tell that a true brewmaster, especially a dwarven brewmaster who put that much into it, would not want you sitting around all downhearted and stuff. It's time to go out and make people pay for the things that have happened and to make merriment, because I promise you that's what Grundar would want.
Yeah, you're right.
Jesus, who are you?
And I'm a samurai. And I go, Kia? I have to save Grundar.
The beginning of that.
Oh, sorry. Is this thing on my button? Does it seem to be working?
I'm glad I'm not the only one that was thinking that. Like, wait, did I miss something?
It was
nicely edited, though, because what I heard was, I'm a samurai, and I go, Kia. And I'm like, holy shit, is she just about to kick this dwarf's ass?
I said I couldn't Kia enough to save Grundar.
Oh.
I was too slow.
I was pretty sure you were Kia-ing the shit out of some stuff, I thought.
Yep. If it hadn't been for her Kia-ing, then everybody would have died, I believe.
Yeah, I honestly, I'm going to have to watch that stream. I can't remember the encounter, and I am starting to understand even more now that it's going to be important to understand it pretty critically.
Well, while y'all were down yonder taking care of business, and the Grundar that's famous for making ale passed on, I've been out, finished up my tour just recently here helping the town. Just come in from a real downpour of rain that was a true frog strangler, and I tell you what, my damn ass is so cold, it's colder than a whale digger's butt in the middle of January. So if anybody has any objections, I'm going to order something stronger than what this is to get the day started.
Yeah.
Is there like a fireplace next to our table?
There's one near to it, yes.
I use Druid Cap to make it come to fire, and then I just, while maintaining eye contact with the dwarf, nod him over. I don't intend to start drinking this morning.
Can you guys hear me?
Yep.
Yes.
Yep. Okay. I pushed the talk button, wasn't working.
That's funky.
It was like lighting up, but nothing was coming out, I guess, because nobody could hear me.
Rick set me up with that random rain that I had to make happen.
So, what are you gonna do now that Grundar's gone?
I don't know. Hopefully he gave somebody a recipe or some hints or something, because I had planned on copying or plagiarizing, if you know what I mean, as much of his drink as I could, because that was some damn good stuff. And I'm telling you that a man can make a living might be enough for me to be able to stop going out and killing all these damn trolls all the time around here, because tell you what, after spending 50 years in the local moon garrison, that's about enough. I've seen more damn trolls than I care to ever see, and you know, it's you get out there and it's some days it's hotter than a goat's ass in a pepper patch, and other days it's cold enough to freeze the tits off a frog. So, you know, God, I'm ready to get over that. Looking for some frogs or tits? Something.
I mean, you can milk frogs, right?
You can milk anything with nipples.
Frogs have nipples.
No.
Well, I have nipples. Could you milk me?
I mean, seriously, this is like real talk, because I don't necessarily want the NSA to just have that as a part of my Google search history, like typing out, do frogs have nipples? That just seems like a bad question to ask.
You'll start seeing ads on Facebook for nipple exactly. frogs.
Bless your heart.
I'm from Texas, I know what that means, so fuck you.
Oh, you dear boy.
Well, are we gonna... I kind of look over to the group and like, should we invite him to come with us?
Well, Roland just looks back down again.
What's your name, sir?
I don't know.
Well, the true name is Danvig Kegbuster, but all my friends call me Keggers.
We could certainly use some more muscle around here. Missing out on Grundar is going to be harsh should the next combat be as difficult as the last.
Well,
I don't know if muscle will cover for Grundar.
Mr. Danvik, I'm going to make you a proposition, but I want you to understand at the outset that it's only on the table if, and I kind of point to Ishii, Raylan, and Wendell, if they all agree to it too. But with that being said, if you would like to take the place of our fallen comrade while we carry out some of our most recent errands, in exchange for your service, should we find it valuable, I'll introduce you to our other comrade who knows the recipe. And perhaps we can learn more about each other on the way. And then I kind of look to the rest of our group.
Raylan kind of looks up. Over and says, perhaps it might be a good idea to know a bit more about the capabilities of our potential companion.
You make a good point.
Dwarves can do anything.
And says, well, yeah, dwarves can do anything, but we don't know what this particular dwarf can do.
Well, I can tell you that I can't carry a tune in a bucket with a lid on it, but other than that, as you can sort of tell by my face, I've been in a scrap or two. Matter of fact, I probably fell out of the damn ugly tree and hit every branch on the way down. However, I'm pretty handy in a fight. I know my way around a troll or 1,000 or so. Been in the moon garrison here for the last 50 years. One of their, I guess, can't really call it battle whenever you're fighting against trolls. Damn things just keep coming, so it's not really a battle. But, you know, made my way around. Haven't lost one in the last, 20 years, I believe, that I've been touring back and forth between here and Nesme. So I guess I heal when I need to and I kill when I need to. And other than that, you know, just as we say in the moon garrison, if you can't run with the big dogs, stay on the porch. And the porch was awful small, so I had to get out there and run quite a bit.
What kind of weapon do you like to use to kill things?
So are you telling me, Trix, that you know when to hold them, that you know when to fold them, and that you also know when to walk away?
Well, I know the first two, but I didn't really learn the last one.
Fucking dad jokes.
Hey, I'm a dad of four. I got this shit all day, brother. So anyway, you ask what I like to use? Well, I prefer to use my fists and my warhammer because everything needs a good cracking every now and then. But, you know, if need be, I can drop a fireball or two here or there. And then, not always the most reliable because in the middle of a fight, you know, sometimes you got to burn a friend or two. But I got some healing to take care of that, too. So, and then, you know, been working on the brewery thing, so if nothing else, I get them good and drunk before I knock them out and try to heal them.
So, out of character-wise, you're a cleric again?
Yep. A lot of cleric. Cool. Clarification.
Okay.
Figured a life cleric was too cliche or whatever.
Hey, I like clerics. They're good.
So, what do you guys think about the proposition I made to our new dwarf friends here?
I see it that we are in a pickle without the strength of Grundar's hammer behind us. So, any help is going to be necessary.
Did you ask him if he owns any taverns?
I was waiting for somebody to say that. I was going to bring it up my first. I didn't want to bring it up first.
Nope, haven't had a chance to. By the time you're going out and slaying trolls, I mean, the damn things keep coming back and regenerating and shit, because not everybody learned that you gotta burn the bastards in order to get rid of them, so they kill them, chop them up, and next damn thing you know, a couple more come back. For so, those, you know, for the, haven't had a chance to sit down and do that, but I have gotten pretty decent, I must say so, at brewing some mushrooms and different things and all to make different types of flavors, but just trust me on this. You don't want to use troll tails. Just trust me. Don't try.
Railing kind of looks over at Ishii. Trolls have tails?
Maybe it's another word for some.
I don't think he knows what trolls are.
What's that? That's right. It's D&D 9.
Winston has no idea what trolls are, by the way. Take care.
Been looking for.
Well, let's just say that the damn things are tall, lanky, and they're so ugly that they'd make a freight train take a dirt road.
Winston knows what trolls are.
Okay, fair enough. Wicko does not.
Okay.
Raylan looks again over at Ishii and says, "What's a freight train?"
Jesus, son, you're slower than a Sunday afternoon.
What's a Sunday?
I know what a... Oh my god.
Do they have Saturday and Sunday and stuff like that in Forgotten Realms?
You're the only person that is not allowed to ask that question, Mr. DM.
Yes, they absolutely do have...
there we go.
There we go. I was actually being serious, though. Like, I'm pretty sure Faerun doesn't have freight trains. So.
Must be a dwarf thing.
Unless, maybe...
What have I been doing with the cell phone in my bags the entire time?
I was wondering how you were able to get all those maps.
That's right. She's got Google Maps.
That does explain a lot in retrospect.
So I kind of wrap my knuckles on the table to get the attention, again, of our distracted compatriots and say, again... Anyone object? Does anyone not want to travel with this dwarf trying to take the place of Grundar? And I look at the dwarf when I say this. He's got very big shoes. Very, very heavy shoes.
Well, his feet were kind of small because he was a dwarf, but...
You're super strong. So
I think he meant in the metaphorical sense.
Oh.
I had a sigh, like, really exasperatedly.
He is in
At this point, Tennessee. We have all said that we're okay with it, but you keep on pushing this.
Are you okay with it, Winston?
No, but it needs to be done. Grendar carried the group. We can't do without him, I think. His death proves that.
We need cuggers like a dog tick on Wednesday needs a moon in the sky on a Thursday.
Nice.
Raylan's like looking between everybody. They're all nodding at this pearl of wisdom, and Raylan's like, what?
Tennessee.
And on whatever this date is, this time in D&D culture, Winston created the first known use of earmuffs as he druid crafts protection over his ears just so he can quit hearing this bullshit.
I, like, slapped Winston's back, like, come on, get in the spirit!
I add more leaves.
Alright, so, Keggers joins the party. You hear the usual dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun as a party member joins, and you step out the door and you see that it has gotten unseasonably cold overnight, snow has begun to fall on the ground. And the barkeep suggests that you pick up some cold weather gear at the local supply house, which I think y'all already did at one point in time, didn't you?
I made a point of doing so, but I don't see it in my inventory.
I think we're just saying that you got it.
We did do this. I don't know if Keggers did, but we definitely did cold weather gear.
That's right.
Yeah.
There was that one travel day where it went like 80 degrees to negative 40 degrees back up to 70 degrees or something crazy.
Yeah. Like, I definitely know that I spent at least 30 minutes of one of our sessions making sure everyone was kitted out, so to speak.
And Keggers would have both hot and cold being around that, and more he's used to those swings or whatever. But upon stepping outside and seeing that it started to snow or whatever, he's like, Jesus, man, I love the way that this weather changes around here. One day it's hotter than blue blazes, next day it's colder than a damn penguin's balls.
I wish they would just pick their mind for a season. Winston grumbles as he changes into his cold.
I'm taking notes to try to figure out all Keggers is talking about half the time.
Are you plugging it into your Google Translate?
I'm just writing down penguins balls, ?
Could be worse. Could be colder than a banker's heart on foreclosure day at the widow's and orphan's home.
Do you have these printed out or in another window?
A couple of them. A lot of them are just coming off of memory.
I
colorful characters.
Dude, I game with you all the time. I know that you've got this shit in spades, but you are rattling them off so quickly and so articulately that I was like, he's got to have these written down.
He sent me a picture of a dry erase board. He's checking them off as he does them.
Actually, I have a notebook that I'm writing. I'm checking them off as I'm going down through them. Too bad it wasn't hot. I had a real good one for being hot.
That's a real character development, because if this one doesn't die, dun-dun-dun, he's going to have to spend, like, game prep time just coming up with new...
Yeah, no shit.
Alright. So, everybody loads into the wagon. Jump up front, you spur the horses on, and travel is slower than usual, given the weather. You get some travel montage music. All right. So you are all going on the journey. Appears to be taken twice as long as normal. You're all huddled down, shielding yourself from the cold. You get about halfway to Zamorban Hall whenever the sun starts to set. So let's see here, Raylan. Where do we go? Alright. Turn down that snow a little bit. I don't know who's walking so heavy in the snow. Probably Ishii stomping around.
Probably one of the horses, because I don't think we're walking.
Oh yeah, that too is the horses. So y'all tell the horses to walk a little quieter. Throw me out a d20 as night begins to fall. Alright. Night begins to set. What kind of camp preparations and whatnot do y'all take?
I'll handle the camp prep, seeing how we're traveling along the outside of that and Moors, Evermoors. This is something that I'm very familiar with. So I break camp with a small fire that's huddled around and position tents or whatever when everybody sets up so that the wind from the west will not blow out the fire.
All right. Who's taking first watch?
I'll take first.
Alright. Alright, so everybody begins to bed down. Raylan, why don't you throw me a perception check in the tower?
Oh, where'd the tower go? There it is. Why does it always do that? Moves it to a weird position on the...
Alright, so your watch of we'll say there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 your watch is about 2 hours long. It is uneventful. Who has
Winston will take second.
Alright, Winston takes second watch. So Raylan, you turn in. Winston, go ahead and give me a perception check in the tower. Alright, your watch is uneventful as well. Another 2 hours passes. Who has the next watch?
I'll take the next one.
Alright, go ahead and give me a perception check in the tower. Your watch goes by uneventful as well, so you turn in. Ishii, why don't you throw me a perception in the tower? Your watch is uneventful as well. And let's do a little Winston here. Or not Winston, Wendell. So Wendell, suddenly, how are y'all? Are y'all like all in one big community tent, or you each have your own tent, or what does y'all's campsite look like?
Whenever I set up separate tents and block the wind or whatever from hitting the, set them up so that the wind would block the wind from hitting the fire.
All right. Alright, so you each are suddenly awakened by the front of your tent being shook, and Wendell, hey guys, I think I heard something moving out in the woods.
Raylan grabs his... Raylan grabs his crossbow and heads out to check it out with whoever else is going.
And so, Ishii, do you go out? Do you stay in bed? Or
I got a roll for that one. I think I would be very tired. Even I go out odd, I'm angry and I go back to bed.
All right.
Oh, back to bed.
back to bed, and you holler some curses at Ed Wendell. Let's see here. Keggers, what about you?
And I hit the wrong damn button, so Yens didn't hear a word of that. So anyway, I am got outside the tent, stood up to look and see what was going on, see if I could look to see anything in there, and then I take a real deep intake of air or whatever, trying to see if I smell anything. Do I smell anything?
Give me a perception check. So, you take a big breath of air and don't smell or hear anything. Wendell points out. Raylan, give me a perception check as well.
Okay, one second. I assume you want it in the tower?
Yes, sir. Alright, so Wendell points out, and Winston, you're kind of the only one that, Keggers and Raylan, you see a shape off in the distance, looks to be about 20 to 25 feet tall. Winston, you see the same shape also, and you see a pair of red eyes looking at y'all about 20 feet off the ground.
I immediately point and call out that information. Large object, 20 feet, that way. And then take, like, a defensive stance.
Raylan will,
Whenever I turn and look at it, because of my history of patrolling the area, would I know what this is?
You know that it is definitely way too big to be a troll. And all of you, with the exception of Ishii, who's still in bed telling y'all to shut the hell up, think that it might be the size of a giant, just from the size that you have seen. This one actually appears to be larger than the ones you've encountered at Tribor.
Well, y'all, I can tell you is that that's not a damn troll, and I don't know, but that thing's big enough to look like it damn sure jerk a knot in your ass.
Is there any information I could try to gather on it?
No, not
with a
from
knowledge
where y'all
check
are at.
Or something like that.
What's that?
With a knowledge check or something like that.
Yeah, give me a history check.
Alrighty.
Yeah, you unfortunately missed that day of your studies.
I have no idea what that is.
You did not roll very well on your history check.
Yeah, I figured as much.
All right.
So while we're all determining that we don't know what the fuck that is or whatever, I kick over some dirt over top of the fire or whatever, put out the fire.
All right. And when the fire goes out, the moon kind of peeks through the clouds just for a second, and you catch a slight little gleam of. What appears to be a giant axe blade.
Is he holding it like in an attack? Is it strapped on his back? Is it dangling from his hand toward the ground while he just stands there? Like, what's the threat?
It appears to be kind of just out in front of him. Not like raised up high like an attack stance. Just kind of almost like he has it out in front of him with his hands resting on top of it.
And you said he's 20 feet from me, right? Like two basketball goals?
No, he's probably about 35 to 40 feet away from you. The figure appears to be about 20 to 25 feet tall, with the red eyes being about 20 feet off the ground. The heavy snow and the wind and stuff is definitely obscuring your view a little bit, or a lot.
And it's the middle of the night, right? Like 2 a.m.?
It's probably about 3, maybe 4 in the morning.
I kind of whisper to Wendell, who is on watch, right?
That is correct.
Did he walk up to our camp and stop, or did he only stop when you noticed him? Like, does he want to talk, or does he want to fight?
Wendell kind of looks at you and is like, well, to be honest with you, I just happened to catch a glimpse of something out of the corner of my eye, and that's when I noticed it. I'm not sure how long they've been there, but they appear to just be watching.
So, I already said that I was in a defensive stance, so I'm going to take my weapon and kind of hold it out in front of me, trying to mimic him, but I'm only going to take, like, 5 steps forward and then stop, just kind of look at him, see what reaction that gets.
The figure pick up his up the axe, and you, from what you can tell, it looks like maybe it shoulders its axe and begins to walk towards you.
Walk?
That's correct, walk.
And you said the axe was slung over on top of his shoulder, not like he's holding it up high?
Yeah, he's got it, like, resting on his shoulder, kind of like you would a baseball bat or something.
Okay. I will remain standing there until he gets, like, 15 feet away, because you said he's 25 feet tall, so I'm assuming that his hit range is 10 feet.
Correct.
So, yeah, if he's 15 feet away, I'm still standing. If he starts getting closer to 10, I'll kind of drop a defensive stance, but I won't raise my weapon at him. I'm just going to have it.
Alright, what are the rest of you doing?
I run over to Ishii's tent, kick open the front of the tent, and go, hey, big gal, you need to get your ass out here, because there's a big fella out here, and he's pretty big. And
for a spankering.
I, like, thrash in my blanket, like, bah!
Teenage tantrum and having to go to school in the morning.
Dang it. Alright, I join him.
I am staying nearby, but kind of in the trees.
Alright. And the figure still approaches you, and as it gets closer, it stops about 15 foot away from you, and it slowly comes into view. You see a giant frost giant clad in plate armor, and has a skull of a white dragon wearing it as a helmet.
Oh shit, son!
Why'd you wake me up for this?
And he says, Now, friends, I am sorry, I did not mean to startle you.
I'm glad to hear you call us friends. But you startled us all the same. What are your intentions?
I was hoping to maybe warm myself some by your fire, but it appears that that is not possible now.
I used druidcraft and make the fire come back to life, and without, you know, keeping my eyes on him, unless you say I can't do that, say, as long as you mean no ill intentions, we'll share our warmth.
Did you say this guy was a frost giant?
That is correct.
So don't want to get warm? Is that like a lie?
So hold on here, brother. Said, I almost feel like you're trying to call an alligator a lizard dust. Said, what's your intentions here, brother? Because I'd hate to have to scramble your eggs for you or cream your corn. You know what I'm saying?
I get a little more defensive once he calls him back.
So Harshnag, or the giant, kind of motions for the dwarf to calm down a little bit and says, my friend, I simply want to take this time to rest and relax. I mean you no ill will. Otherwise, I could have set upon you while you were sleeping. I have been watching you for quite some time to see if you might be hostile or not.
How the hell did we miss a frost giant? As I like
look Winston kind of glares at Wendell
at the rest of the watch people.
Can I roll insight or something on this guy?
Yeah, absolutely.
That's smart.
Yep, whoever wants to roll insight, you can in the tower. And
is this Moss with the insight?
He looks to you, Ishii, and says, begging your pardon, ma'am, but it was this one here that caught wind of me, and he motions to Wendell. I would ask what the rest of you were doing on your watch.
Listen, guy. I'm going back to bed.
You all...
I mean, that's a pretty good response.
He has no will, no ill will towards you.
What is your name, giant?
I am known in these parts as Harshnag.
Harshnag, you say you want to share the warmth of the fire, I am Winston, and I'll allow you to do so, but my condition is you drop your weapon where you stand and approach unarmed. I don't know you.
I kind of step out and say, we've had some very poor dealings with your kind recently. You have to understand that,
giants are fucking crazy right now. Winston just fucking goes off.
You see a little smile come across his face as he says, well, then I believe that it is fate that might have brought us together, for that is the very reason why I am out tonight, hunting giants.
Really now? That's an interesting tale, to be sure. A giant hunting his own?
Well, my full name is Harshnag the Grim, and I am a member of the Force Grey of Waterdeep. But if you allow me to have a seat at your fire and rest, I shall fill you in on a little information as to why perhaps the giants are becoming so reckless as of late.
I welcome your knowledge, Harshnag, but my condition remains. Quite frankly, I don't trust any stranger right now, and I've already welcomed one. No offense, my friend Davnik. I don't call him Keggers yet because he hasn't told me I'm his friend. But one's enough, so drop your weapon if you wish to approach, or we can continue conversing where we are, and we'll remain ready to defend ourselves.
Winston, yep, that is right. What you typed out.
Sweet.
He says, well, I will meet you halfway, and I will sheathe my weapon, and I will sit where I am. And you all can be amongst your fire, and I will be here. And I shall tell you the story of why the giants are acting the way that they are.
When he sheathes his weapon, I put my club away and take up my staff and kind of lean on it, trying to pretend it's a walking stick instead of a staff. But I stay standing and...
Yeah. Picture with you.
Fuck, that's big.
That's what she said.
Yeah, he is one big ass giant.
She did not say that because she's dead.
All right, so Harshnag says, so tell me, my friends, have you heard of the Ordning?
Ordning?
The what now?
The Ordning. Yes, that is correct, Winston.
No, we haven't.
No.
What do you know of giants and the odor of giants?
I think for the sake of your tale, Harshnag, you should consider us ignorant.
Very, very well. I have
learned. And he starts talking, Winston's going to bring some firewood and kind of throw it closer, because I'm not getting in his range, especially now that I know how big he is. But once he's big enough, I'm going to light a fire for him.
Well,
once there's enough wood, rather.
My friends, you see, us giants have something called the Ordning. The Ordning that keeps the giants in check of one another. From your storm giants down to your cloud giants, your frost giants to your fire, to all the way down to your lowly hill giants. Sort of a chain of command is, I guess, a way that you would explain it to you all. Do you know what I speak?
Yeah, like a king and a queen and stuff.
And he nods at that. Well, it appears that the Ordning has been broken, and that the storm giants are no longer able to keep the smaller giants in check.
What caused this?
The king of the giants, King Hecaton, has gone missing.
When did King Hecaton, king of the giants, go missing? Exactly.
So he, by his best guesstimates, it lines up with about a week or two before the attack, or before you first saw the giant shoe floating in the sky. So maybe a month or so ago.
Okay. Continue.
And since then I have been on the hunt to eliminate those evil giants that are out wreaking havoc. But I realized that I cannot eliminate them all, so I was actually on my way to the spine of the world. Tell me, have you heard of such a place?
I have not, but before you elaborate, may I ask you a question?
He nods at you.
Forgive my ignorance, and I mean no judgment, because us humans... Wait, am I... I'm not playing a human, I'm playing a fucking elf. Us elves, we have the same issue where certain elves go bad and are just crazy or deranged from the beginning, but these giants, these evil giants that you're hunting, were they always evil? And King Hecaton just kept them in line, or did something else happen after the king went missing to make them go reckless and rampage, where previously they stayed away?
That is correct, but there is more to it. They were always evil, kept in check by King Hecaton, but now that he has gone missing, all the giant clans are fighting for power. So,
okay, that is enlightening.
Are getting quite reckless.
The Spire of Wonder, I think you mentioned. I am not familiar with that either. I'm quite ignorant, as I mentioned, but I'm learning. Gotcha. World.
Well, it is up north. North of where we are, as a matter of fact. And the place in particular that I was going to is called the Eye of the Allfather. It is a place few giants know of, to where I hope to consult the Oracle to see what can be done to set things back the way they are and locate the king.
Can you... How would you do that?
He kind of looks at you, puzzling. How would I do what?
How would you set things right and get your king back? Is he at the Eye of the Allfather? You know that?
I do not think that I would be so lucky, but I hope to consult the Oracle at the Eye of the Allfather to find out what
the Oracle. I see. So this is a divination, a prophetic person.
And he nods at that.
So a month, this is me to DM out of character, a month has happened since King Hecaton went missing, or has it been like 6 weeks ago he went missing, and for the last month there's been giant shit happening?
I would say probably a month. Well, a week is 10 days, so we're going to say 40 days ago he went missing, and the past 3 weeks the giants have been rampaging.
Gotcha. Okay, that's even easier. I like the 10 system. 40 days ago, King went missing. The last 30 days, giant shit everywhere.
Yep.
And this whole time, he's just been sitting there with a sheathed weapon. He's never stretched or got on his stood up for anything, whatever. He's been totally domesticated, for lack of...
Yeah, he has enjoyed telling y'all his tale.
Retroactively, for you know the last five or six things, he's
you believe every word that he says. So he, Harshnag says, I have a question for y'all. What are you doing in these parts?
I look to Davnik and say, Davnik, you have more experience with frost giants than I imagine, since this is my first. How fill you?
His doorbell rang.
Davnik, I'm here. Please leave a message. Beep.
That's right. He's just a husk of a person sitting there.
This is why I love it when people animate the D&D sessions, because they draw like the character just like sitting there. Hello? Wait,
can you link me some examples? I would love to see that.
Any of the ones from who are the guys that always get like... Hold on one sec. They were in Pillars of Eternity.
I started to play that game, but my computer crapped out on me before I finished. I should revisit that.
Critical Role does... You don't like them?
No. We'll talk about that later.
I don't know. They did a lot of voices for Pillars of Eternity, too. I thought they did really good.
I'm a fan.
Yeah, his wife did, like, four different females, and then you couldn't even...
Yeah, like, I mean, when I first found Critical Role, I found a Reddit post where someone linked out, like, basically their full IMDb truncated to just video game voiceovers that they've done that were popular. And it's like, it's just all of the Hallmark games that I've enjoyed over the years and thought, hey, you know, that was a pretty good experience or immersion or voice actor they were a part of. they're, you know, they're talented for sure.
I like them as people, but what I have found is that sometimes they give newcomers to D&D false expectations as to what D&D should be.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I can. Yeah. I'll grant you that for sure.
Yeah, that's definitely been an issue ever since the popularity of Critical Role and Acquisitions Incorporated and all of these other
popular D&D streams,
podcasts and things like that. The thing you have to remember is your game is not going to look like that because those people are professional actors.
Yeah, and they're putting on a show playing a game. Like, that's their form of entertainment. The same way that, you know, people playing football is no different than the six-year-old to go and do it at the park. These are just professional people who have turned it into a form of getting paid. And trust me, they're getting, making no illusion, but I still get enjoyment out of it. I don't watch it. I watch the first campaign. The second one, I kind of dabble in when I don't have anything else to do, but I haven't done it for months.
Yeah, I mean, I am not a professional by any means. I'm not even wearing pants right now.
You are a professional because I'm paying you for this. That's the definition.
Yeah, that's true, I guess so. And I appreciate that on your self-playing tricks being wonderful Patreons. But moving forward... okay, when was going to be home in 20 minutes? Trix is back now.
Yep, I'm back.
What was the last thing that you heard before you stepped away, Trix?
He was yelling about the ordaining, the hierarchy of them, and I guess the king couldn't hold his own or some shit, and he's gone missing, and now because of that, everybody else is uprising, because apparently he was a badass keeping everybody in order, and now nobody can.
So, summary after that, to make it quick, if you know where we are, it's northwest. There's the Eye of the Allfather. That is evidently where Harshnag was on the way to, because there's an oracle there. So he was going to talk to this oracle and see if he could get some answers about where the king is. Because while he's killing all these evil giants that are being, you know, were being kept in line by the king that are now running wild, that's his ultimate goal.
AG Draco 2, how are you doing?
He has been completely in character. You know, while you're standing next to me, I said to you, I think he's told the truth this whole time. It's my read on him. But you know Frost Giants better. What is your feel on him?
All right, so are we back in character now?
Yep, that was my in-game question to you.
Well, this don't look like this is his first rodeo, and dadgummit, he got all gussied up for...
Yeah,
we don't want him to get all gussied up for nothing, so
this group
I say we go with him and see what's happening.
Just this campaign in general.
Yeah, that could be fun. I mean, I don't know how we're supposed to fight giants, but...
I absolutely love it.
Yeah.
Hey, well, you just run around and you hit them in the knees, and whenever they fall down, you smack them right in the face. It's pretty easy, really.
Wendell, Raylan, what do you guys think?
If it gives us a chance to deal with the threat of these giants posed to the villages and towns all throughout here, I say we should take it.
And Wendell?
Wendell gives a thumbs up.
So, I'm in agreement as well. Davik, Harshnag... One thing that you should both know is on our way to the Eye of the Allfather, if my geography serves me right, we'll be passing very near to Zamorven Hall, and we have it under good authority. There is a giant slaying weapon there of enchantments, so it may behoove us to make at least that stop on our way to the Eye of the Allfather. What do you guys think?
Yes, we need giant slaying weapon. No offense, giant guy.
Yeah. He nods at you and kind of grips the head of his axe and says, while this may not be a giant slaying weapon of magical enchant, it has slain its share of giants.
Let me look at that thing.
So he unsheathes it and sets it on the ground, and it is twice the size of you.
Damn.
Ooh,
wait,
doggy,
that is how size. Tall is Kickers?
Good question.
I mean, because it may just be like 6 feet, you know, and that, like, that's still impressive, yeah. But it's not a damn impressive. So I need to check myself.
Keggers is laying down in the snow, marking himself, and then getting back up and figuring it out. The axe looks to be about 10 feet tall.
Damn.
Well, I'd say you could use that doohickey anytime you wanted to, because it looks damn sure big enough to take care of something.
So, has Wendell's watch, like, ended, or was he, like, 1 hour into it, or
yeah,
how did
yeah,
that
that's
work?
What I was getting to. So the sun slowly starts to come up. The weather is definitely starting to subside a little bit. And Harshnags, well, my friends, if you don't mind, we have a rather long journey in front of us. I suggest that we be on our ways.
Indeed, with our first stop being Zimorvan Hall. And we pack up.
Right. So, as you're traveling, you notice something odd. The fact that...
Besides the 25-foot tall giant walking behind our cart?
And making no means to hide himself from sight whatsoever. Just strolling around like he owns the place.
Because he's a 25-foot tall giant. Oh, that's a funny visual.
Just acting like he totally fits in. Right. I did not mean for the weather to go all the way away.
So while we're on the way to Zimorvan Hall, I imagine everyone's in the cart besides the giant.
Correct.
So like if we can finagle it like where Keggers is driving and the rest of us are in the back, I'm not necessarily trying to keep him from hearing, but I'm not necessarily talking to Keggers as the new guy. But I tell Ishii, Raylan, and Wendell all about the dream that I had after Grundar died, in as much detail
right,
as I can remember.
I know what you meant,
and I make a very important note of stressing, like, and I heard Grundar's voice. It was no mistake. He said, you know, she is coming. I don't know if he's talking about that giant Kraken squid thingy or something else. I have no idea. I'm just trying to tell you what I am remembering because, you know, this is happening a lot. More than I want it to.
I'm sorry I had to deal with that. I have no clue what he's talking about.
I've told him about the other dreams I've had, right?
I know you told him about the one in when y'all were in Tribor. I'm not sure about the other ones.
Okay, well, I do a complete recap of all the dreams I've had thus far in our illustrious campaign in as much detail as, you know, my Grundara ale impaired ass is able to remember them.
And so, and as you're recounting the tales, Zymorvan Hall comes into view. And if y'all remember, you were supposed to find Lord Harthost Zymorvan.
We sure were.
Right. So you make your way in. Harshnag kind of hangs a couple hundred yards outside of town and says that he will be more than happy to watch the horses and the wagon if that would be all right.
Yeah, thanks.
I'm a real boy. Right, so you all head in. You're escorted to Lord Zymorvan, and he greets you all and asks what you what brings you to the town.
Greetings, Lord. Ergula told us to come and fight.
He gets a grin at this. Ah, Ergula, I have not seen her in ages, it seems like. Tell me, what? Why did she send you to see me? Does she wish to meet and go on more adventures again? I am afraid I am rather old for that.
Well, to be completely honest, Lord, we came in search of tools necessary to defend the townships. I don't know if you've heard, but all across the across the Sword Coast, all the way up as far as Waterdeep, nearly, and even farther, there have been attacks made. Giants have been storming settlements and killing only when people get in their way, but they're destroying these towns. And Ergula mentioned that you may have possession of a weapon that is particularly suited for taking out these giants.
So he, you see this sad look come over his face, almost like a look of disappointment. I did have this great weapon that you speak of, but it brings me sadness to report to you that my son Harthel has stolen this weapon.
Your son has stolen it?
Did you say Harthel?
Harthel. Harthal. Yes, he committed this act after I disowned him for marrying a thief from the town of Yatar.
Yeah, I guess it's appropriate that he stole something then.
How unfortunate. That is hard to hear in this day and age.
Yes, I wish I had better news for you, and I hope that you did not travel all this way just to seek this out.
Well, there is the possibility that we could help in tracking him down. The honest truth is, I have difficulty hearing that somebody has stolen something, especially something so valuable, and is going to escape justice. As Raylan kind of is sitting there with his watch insignia on and all of that stuff.
Well, as I said, I am rather old, and adventuring is not really on my horizon. If If you do find my son and find this weapon, you may keep it as payment for bringing my son to justice.
Do you have any idea where he may have absconded to?
Yartar.
Oh, that's right. You did say that. I'm sorry. I have been distracted.
It's like right below the inn in Deseran Valley. Southwest of Silvery Moon. It looks like it would take several days to get there.
Yeah, that's going to be something we'd have to do if we were going to go back toward Tribor. That is not a simple track, that's for sure. We'd have to, either that or, I mean, we could cross the Evermoors, but that would take even longer.
And that's swampy area too, so you would definitely be giving up your horses and cart and stuff.
Exactly.
Yeah, I mean, it sounds like this is something that we're going to have to, put on the back burner. Back burner.
The Eye of the Allfather is far to the north. We're going to need to make more preparations before we would go up there anyway, right? Like, there's no roads through the Valley of Kedron.
Roads? Where we're going, we don't need any roads.
And if we're going in that direction anyway, we could easily stop through Yartar on our way to Tribor to resupply and head north. But either way, I think it would make the most sense to see if we can go to Citadel Felbar and perhaps we can gain some assistance from the King and Queen there before we head out.
With a frost giant in tow?
You make a good point.
So I'm assuming that that after all this, y'all head back out to the wagon where Harshnag is?
Oh, yeah. Definitely, eventually.
Yeah.
And so Harshnag asks, he sees you come back empty-handed and asks what became of the weapon.
Some asshole stole it.
Yeah. It's a frown look upon his face and says, well, shall we continue on towards the Eye of the Allfather? The East Coast trying to figure out your...
That depends.
I kind of want to get the weapon.
I'm Central Time.
It depends on how much we care about
to
being fully prepared before we head into the...
Around 9:30, so probably about an hour and a half.
Our current mode of transportation is serving us well, but it will not there.
Well, I always found that the best path is one that is straight. I will accompany you through the woods and the plains and whatnot, and make sure no ill will befalls you. However, if you wish to part ways and head to Yartar, I respect that. But I'm afraid I do not know if our paths will cross again.
I gotta say, guys, if we're going to the Allfather, who is a prophetic diviner type person, probably be a lot easier with the big ass frost giant on our back.
Yeah, I'm looking at this big ass frost giant's probably better than some weapon we're going to get.
And, exactly. Like, I mean, seriously, really. And once we get there and this diviner thing has information about where the king is, I mean, I don't imagine Harshnag is the type of person who's going to find the answer to his problem and then just sit on his ass and wait for us to catch up. I imagine he's going to go on. And as powerful as he may be, the chance of success of a rescue or whatever it may be is going to be better with all of us, because we're not weak ourselves. Ishii, I know you want this weapon, and I won't deny its usefulness, but I think we might be better served going with the giant to the Allfather and seeing what's up from there. Who knows? It may be that we need to go through Yartar to wherever the king may be, and we'll do that with the frost giant on our side.
Okay, that sounds good.
I agree.
I concur.
Wendell? Keggers?
Wendell gives a thumbs up.
Good.
Oh, that's right. We'll go with you, Harshnag.
Alright, so he nods at that and begins to lead the way. So let's see here. That is take 4 or 5 days. Alright, so let's see here.
Wendell's we don't want to kill our horse and get our cart marooned, so whenever we intellectually know, we'll
that is very
stable
true.
It along.
So he leads y'all to the town of Rivermoot, where there you leave your horses and whatnot. Hey, there's Wendell. Hello, Wendell.
Hello.
Greetings.
So I will let somebody recap everything for you before we proceed.
Not it.
Not it.
Yep. to put things simply, we left from Silvery Moon to make our way towards Zymorven Hall. And on our way there, we met a frost giant who informed us that the reason the giants have been going crazy of late is because of something called the Ordning being broken. We're currently traveling with this frost giant north to the Eye of the Allfather, where there is a prophetic of a sort giant that may or may not be the source of all of this, or may be able to tell us what we need to do. It's a little bit hazy on that particular front, but we're making our way there. We did stop in Zymorven Hall to check on the quest that Urgula gave us regarding the Giant Slayer weapon. However, the weapon had been stolen by Lord Zymorven's son, and he assumes that it was taken with him to the town of Yartar, which is all the way down in the Deseret Valley, in the opposite direction of where we need to go. So, for the time being, we are getting ready to make our way through the Lurkwood north to into the spine of the world.
Okay.
Sounds like a wiener. One second here. And Fantasy Grounds just crashed. Yay!
Oh, yay!
Well, I get everything loaded back up. Y'all want to take a quick... We'll take a quick little 8-minute bio break.
Sounds good.
Sounds good. BRB.
Oh, and by the way, Wendell, my new dwarf named Keggers uses as many southern slang colloquialisms as he can in his speech.
Did you say his name is Keggers?
Mm-hmm.
Nice.
Bear with me here one second, folks. While I get Fantasy Grounds loaded back up, everybody's gonna take a quick little bio. So while Fantasy Grounds and stuff's loading up, let me just welcome everybody to the stream. We are currently playing Storm King's Thunder. I think this is episode 6. Party's just met up with Harshnag and are headed to Eye of the Allfather. If you want to see our previous streams and whatnot, check out our YouTube channel.
Hey there, silly little sailor. Welcome aboard my boat.
Thanks for the follow. Do a little social media thing. So that's got all our links, our Facebook page. We announce our games and whatnot. YouTube channel is going to have our previously recorded games. Twitter and Instagram post some real life pictures of the gaming I do other than Fantasy Grounds. We also have a podcast if you like podcast kind of stuff on Google and iTunes and whatnot. FSH Schmo's Amazing Tabletop Podcast is the name of it. Sorry for the little rambling on there. Ooh, don't want to share that just yet. That would have been bad. So hopefully this does not cause Fantasy Grounds to crash again. Yay, it does not. And also kind of like in our off time when we're not playing D&D, we like to play Lord of the Rings Online. I don't know if anybody here plays that or not. If you do, definitely check us out. A couple of us play. Here we go. All right, we're good. All right, so like we said, quick little bio. I will be right back in just a couple of minutes. Don't go anywhere. Server is back up, by the way.
Thank you.
Yeah, I get that, Draco. Totally get that.
It's trying to connect.
Yep, everybody is loading in at once. Please be patient.
I'm back.
Welcome back.
Looking to see. What level? I want to say the character should gain a level. Okay, it looks like we still got people loading in. I know there's a spot in here for what level people should be as they go. And of course, I cannot find it. Running the adventure is not there. And each chapter is a character advancement sidebar. Level 7, yes. Alright, so at the end of this session then. Nice. Looks like everybody's here. Do a quick little ready check. Give me a check if you're ready. Excellent. All right, so if everybody will roll me a d20 out in the open. Winston, it was just the world map that was up. Ooh, a couple of 20s. See what happens. Eight. Well, fortunately, that's rather uneventful. All right, so your journey, is uneventful. The road does end up turning treacherous as you make it closer up to the eye of the world. You scale up through icy mountains, and trying to get to it here. All right. Let me queue this up. There we go. Right. So yeah, you end up finding yourself. The path narrows to kind of like an ice bridge that leads over to a domed structure that is carved into the side of a mountain. You are several hundred yards off, and this is what you see.
Can you put the party token that's in Rivermoot on wherever we are now, where we see that thing?
Yeah.
Spoopy.
Where'd the party token go? Oh, there it is. And you see it?
I do. Thank you.
Yep.
So we're there.
Yep.
So I guess we're just waiting on following Harshnet.
Right, and here we go. Have a minute to load up for you. I think I shared it with you. Okay. Just kind of gives you an idea of your size compared to his size.
Yeah.
Alright, so before you is a 40-foot wide, naturally formed stone causeway that leads into the entrance. The cliffs plunge hundreds of feet on both sides of the entrance. The causeway is covered in with a foot of snow, and you do notice that there are fresh tracks leading into what appears to be a temple. Carved into the mountainside are six stone pillars that are supporting the dome. Winston, you determine that the tracks are humanoid, but you cannot tell of what type of humanoid nor how many. Harshnag sees you kind of looking at this, Winston, and says, I'm afraid that I share your curiosity as well, for I did not think there were many alive that knew of this place.
I can't tell how many there are.
Then I suggest that we be on our guards then. And he unsheaths his axe and kind of just holds it very relaxed.
That looks like a big axe.
And he throws a wink to you and proceeds on. Moving in into the domed area. How do the rest of you follow?
Yep.
All right, so as you approach, yes. You notice the pillars. One has a hill giant lifting a rock above its head, a frost giant chopping down a great pine, a cloud giant flying among the birds, a storm giant hurling lightning bolts at a ship, a stone giant climbing a mountain, and a fire giant with a dwarf chained prisoner in a cavern.
So six symbols, but four pillars?
There's six pillars. One's like in the directly to the south.
Oh, okay.
And directly to the north, yeah.
I just assumed assuming on this part of the mountain. I got you.
Alright, so the snow begins to dissipate as you move further into the temple. But the tracks do continue onward into the temple as well.
Can I roll an investigation check to see if there's any indication of how old these tracks are?
You can, yes. So you see that the it is a passageway carved into the mountain. So this actually leads into the mountain that was carved out.
We would do well to stay on our guard. Who knows what we're waiting for?
Nope, it is not exposed to the sky above. It's actually it is a tunnel. So Raylan, as you're checking out these tracks, you stand up and out of the top of your eye, you see giant blocks that appear to be suspended up above you. These blocks are as wide as the hallway, and each one looks to be 20 feet thick. You get the impression that if these blocks were to fall on you, that they would squish you flat. Wendell, what are you looking for?
Well, I just happen to look up and try to see if I can see any of the see if I suspect it as actually being a trap and see if I see the mechanism.
You do, just from your knowledge of traps and whatnot from your burglary days, you do know that there must be some kind of mechanism within this place that, if tripped, would bring these crashing down.
All right.
All right, Harshnag continues on. All right, there we go. So moving into here, the ceiling goes from 40 foot to 60 feet high. And you see landings on each side that are 20 feet off the ground.
How big are the landings? I mean, could humanoids stand on them, or giants, or what?
They are big enough for giants to stand upon.
The passageway that we're on, is it just cobblestone, dirt path? Or are there rails? Or anything?
It is, it's just like an ornate stone hallway carved into this mountain. So you're kind of like if you were in a dwarven city underground of sorts.
But there's no runes or anything arcane looking on the stone or the top?
Nope, there are not.
Okay.
Let's see here. Everybody has. Yep. So, when Harshnag gets to here, he kind of holds up a hand and that motions for y'all to stop and points towards, and you see Give me a perception check as he kind of points forward. We'll see if y'all see what he sees. So Winston, you see the flicker of torchlight up ahead, about 70 to 80 feet.
I say in a voice loud enough as a whisper that I think only our group hears, torchlight ahead.
And you hear grunts of a humanoid nature that kind of are carried down the hallway or down the passageway.
There's someone up there, for sure.
Somebody constipated.
All right, what would y'all like to do?
How high is the ceiling?
60 feet.
Taking just a second or two to kind of look at Harshnag. What does his attention appear to be? Like, is he looking at us, or is he making his own move?
He kind of looks to y'all and also has a look of curiosity, on his face. He's just as puzzled as to why people would be here as y'all are.
Looters, maybe?
I will say, Harshnag, maybe you could wait here and crouch down, be quiet. Wendell, could you scout ahead carefully, cautiously, maybe see what's going on?
Sure.
Wendell, give me a stealth check. One second. All right, so you see eight individuals that appear to be trying to get the doors open and are having no such luck.
Like, what types of individuals?
They look to be of barbarian nature, and with them also is a what appears to be a wormling.
A what now?
I will share it with Wendell.
That's fair.
Wormling or that thing?
That thing.
That's not a wormling.
That's what it's called. It's just the image.
So I make my way back to the party and let them know that there is eight things in a mini white dragon up there.
Define mini.
Oh boy.
Well, wormlings are supposed to essentially be like what? Essentially tiny baby dragons, kind of.
Wormling. Okay, like WYRM worm.
Yes, but the picture I'm being shown is like adult dragon.
So there's eight humans in there? And a what appears to be a adult dragon is what you're saying.
The picture I'm showing is like adult white dragon, but the DM in my head keeps telling me it's a wormling.
That it's a baby version of that picture.
So, okay, so when you're describing this to Winston, who's very like insistent, how big is it compared to
the baby white dragon?
Like, okay, is that 10 feet? Is that 20 feet? Is that 50 feet? Is that 100 feet?
If Wendell had to guess, it would occupy a 5-foot square.
Okay. Yeah, that's what I kind of figured a wormling was.
Okay.
It is a medium creature.
So that's not an adult dragon by any means?
No.
Okay.
Sorry, it's the picture that Shmo gave me is like That's not a wormling.
Okay, fair enough. Okay. So there's eight humans looking things trying to open a door, and a 20-ish footish dragon thing looking thing, baby-ish dragon thing, just hanging out.
There you go, a large dog or a... Yeah, that's chat said it would be about the size of a large dog or a dire wolf.
Okay, so I'm picturing like a Great Dane wolf thing.
Keggers, what are dragon. You inciting for?
Checking to see if I can tell whether their intentions are evil or good.
From that far away, you have no idea.
At least he wasn't trying to see if I was drunk.
The Harshnag says, well, I mean...
Get in there, Harshnag.
We can simply walk up and say hello, if that's fine with y'all. I am not...
No, you are wearing a white dragon head on your head, so get in there, biggin.
I was about to say, I don't think there's a whole lot that'll mess with a giant.
This is your territory, Harshnag, so we follow your lead, but if they turn hostile, which our recent history has led us to believe most things that we meet in the wild will, we have your back, but we have each other's first. No hard feelings.
He understands at that, and motions for y'all to kind of, you know, come on this way, and he...
Hey there, silly little sailor.
He approaches.
Hey,
thanks for the follow. I appreciate that. And he says, hello there, friends. Might I help you with that door there? It appears that you might be having some trouble. And they kind of turn around and look at him and nod a little bit. And so he sheathes his weapon and walks past him. Have these guys move out of the way.
Aren't these the same guys that landed on the shoe and threatened us?
No, those were shield dwarves, weren't they?
Yes.
Are these the other guys that landed on the shoe and threatened us?
No, those were Cult of the Dragon or something.
Oh, okay.
Cult of the Destroyer, that's right.
Yeah, something like that. Cult of Elemental Evil or some kind of crap or something. Alright, so Harshnag begins to throw his shoulder into the door, and you begin to hear ice and stuff kind of crack on the door as it begins to move a little bit.
Do these guys have weapons out and stuff?
Yes, as he's moving in and begins to shoulder the door, they begin to back away and draw their weapons, and everybody roll initiative.
Ah, damn it! Could I move here before the initiative?
Yes.
Like, okay.
So everybody.
Would you say that I was watching to see if they draw their weapons, I was going to change into an animal form as it happened?
Like,
if you have high initiative, maybe.
Yeah, like I was waiting for any sign of hostility, and I was going to immediately turn into my giant constrictor snake.
Yay.
But I don't know if you will allow that to happen.
Let's roll initiative and see how that goes.
I know I'm going last. Oh, maybe not.
So Winston, let's see here. Let's we'll give you a 50-50 shot. So roll a d20. 1 through 11. Yeah, that's a negative.
I respect it.
All right. So let's see here. Du-du-du-du-du. Wendell, you are up, sir.
also kind of harsh, Nag, to be right there, right next to the berserkers.
And he's got the door open, so I don't know if he can, like, attack or...
Let's see, I will use this. This does more damage.
Who were you shooting at? Oh, 12, I see.
Oh, I think I actually grabbed the damage instead of the attack weapon. Hold on.
That's fine. Yeah, go ahead and just roll against him, so we'll see if you hit him. Yep, you hit him.
Yay! Pew, pew!
Alright, number this guy here, where is he? He is there. Goes running up and will swing his great axe. What is this? Da-da-da-da-da. Going to swing with his great axe at Ishii and miss. All right, this person here, what kind of shenanigans are they gonna get up to? Let's do this upright with some spirit guardians. Isn't that the square 15 foot radius?
Focused on the guy.
Gonna drop it right. Oh, it's focused on the guy.
Yeah, whoever casts, right. It's focused around them.
Thank you for reminding me. So we will not do that just yet. But instead, we'll he will just loose a short bow at Ishii.
Bring it on!
Just go for the old traditional stuff. Right, Ishii, you're up.
Okay.
Don't wander too far in.
You're breaking up, wasn't it?
I'm just gonna hit the guy next to me.
Okay.
Shmo, keep that 20-foot radius thing up.
Oh, I forgot that it was self, so they didn't cast it yet. Oh, you're going to. I got you.
Ugh. Friggin' sucks. See, is there anything else I can do? I don't really want to use Fighting Spirit yet. I sheathe my katana.
All right. Number 19 here. I'm going to run up and swing at Ishii and hit. Decent damage. Alright, this guy here. Run up, swing at Winston. Hit. And this guy here. Move to here and attack Ishii. Miss. This guy here. Here and swing at Winston. Miss. Guy here. Here and attack Winston. Hit. Keggers, you're up.
Can I move that?
Where would you like it to be moved to?
To where the very edge of it is hitting the Wormblood and Berserker 9 and Berserker 12 on this side, and yeah.
Like right about there or so?
Yep.
Right.
So I have to target each one of them whenever I'm using a spell that does that, right?
Correct.
All right, here we go.
Fireball!
I can't see all that.
That's fine. Just roll the damage and it'll do what it needs to.
So I hold my hand up in the air or whatever and call upon Morden and go, "How's this, you bastards, for something that I learned while I was in the swamp?"
That's right. Fire nuke. Nuke them from orbit.
And I cast Fireball on them. And that would be the end of my turn.
All right. All right, so this...
What the fud?
What? This,
How'd you do that much damage?
That's what a third level spell is capable of.
You don't remember that from Strahd ruining y'all?
Why the hell am I using the stupid sword?
Alright, so this guy here... Oh, that's sounds like a lot of fun. Jumps and takes
that flight. That does not sound good.
What was that, Spell?
It jumps, takes flight, and lands right there. And we'll let loose a little cold breath.
Okay. Hold on just a second.
Yep.
I need to check something. Oh, never mind. He's not actually doing it. All right. Yeah. Go ahead.
There's a little bit of that.
Ow.
This guy here. Moves right there. Can't do anything else. Arshnag. Takes a step back, and while he moves, pulls out his axe and swings it at the shaman. Hitting. He's gonna come down with two hands because he doesn't like this kind of stuff. And cleaves her right in half.
Yeah! Let's see if Fireball do that.
5. And takes another step to there. And we'll swing again. Hitting. Alright, Raylan, you're up.
Alright, Raylan is, Not in very good shape and not in a very good place. So
D&D
within range.
Where roleplay and storytelling takes right, 5 minutes
I'm
and
going
combat
to
takes
have
5 hours.
Move up to here. Wait, can I start a move, cast a spell, and then continue a move?
Absolutely.
Okay. So I'm going to start a move to here, cast haste on Ish.
Alright.
I hear the blunder starting.
And, let's see, as a bonus action, I am going to grant, Bardic Inspiration to Keggers, I basically pull the horn off my belt and blow clarion call, military attack for keggers. So on your next within the next 10 minutes you can roll a die.
Yeah.
And add a d8 to that die. If you don't like the number that you see, you just can't know whether it succeeds or fails. But it can be after nice. You roll the die. Obviously, it has to be for a d20 check. But yeah. And then I'm going to finish up that movement by backing the heck up.
All right.
To there.
All right, Winston.
Oh, wait, I went 5 feet too far. It would be there.
You turn it into a snake now?
Yeah, the giant constrictor snake.
There you go. I know I was listening to a podcast of Robert Schwab play a game. It was an old Hextile game, which, by the way, Rob's Basement is an amazing podcast. You should check it out. Anyways, he...
So if the attack misses, then the grapple doesn't hit, right?
That would be correct. Like, every square that you move, you have to roll to, like, do something.
That's my crazy.
The berserker here will attack Winston. Miss. Winston, you're up again.
Again. Oh, right. I always forget this.
Oh, that I reroll initiative?
Yeah.
Flanking.
Nice. Oh, I don't know that they've actually seen a mammoth yet, though, to transform.
Wow, really?
Even with advantage, they missed. All right, this berserker here will attack Ishii and miss. Berserker here will do the same and critically hit. Rayland, you're up.
Wow.
Whatever.
So have you, Draco, have you played any kind of Shadow of the Demon Lord or
all right, so,
anything like that?
I would like to roll a knowledge check on the wormling to determine whether or not it is immune to mind-affecting type spell.
Give me a history check. Uh, You have absolutely no idea. Other than the fact that whatever cold breath comes out of its mouth hurts. So Shadow of the Demon Lord is designed by Robert Schwab, who, if you look in almost any one of your 5th edition books, is one of the designers.
Take the horn and move from the clarion call that I've been blowing and change it up to where it's playing so softly that most of you can't hear over the din of battle. However, the wormling can.
I think it's pretty loud battle music.
The wormling is going to be given a wisdom saving.
He fails.
Excellent. All right, so he takes some damage, some psychic damage, 11 points of it. And then he has to use its reaction, if available, to move as far as its speed allows away from me.
All right.
Good job.
That's as far as it can move. Otherwise, it would end up being Sharon Squares.
Yeah, no, that's fine. I think that's what the spell means when it says as far as it can. And then I'm going to move up again next to Wendell and kind of pat him on the shoulder and say, best I could do for you. Get in there. And I continue blowing the...
Out of character, that was pretty badass.
I thought you were going to bust out the horn and be like, I am ready to rock!
Nice.
Alright, so Harshnag's gonna swing at this guy. Splitting him down the middle.
Harshnag, hurry it up! I'm dying!
And then he is going to swing at this guy here. Lopping his head off, hitting Ishi with it. Spraying her with blood.
Yay!
Didn't do an opportunity attack on him because usually forced movement does not grant opportunity attacks, I believe. Ooh. So this one will turn around and bite Ishi in the buttocks.
Real quick, before you... never mind.
Misses. Nope, what were you going to say?
Nothing. Wouldn't have mattered.
See here. Wormblood's going to swing at Winston and miss. This one's going to swing at Ishi and miss. This one's going to swing at Winston and hit.
Real quick, before you roll damage on that...
Okay.
No, I guess... Again, never mind.
No, you're good. You're good. What's up?
I'm going to use my cutting words ability.
Okay.
To attempt to negate that hit. Give me just a second.
Yeah, hurry up and kill it. We don't have all day.
I'm going to roll a d8 here. Subtract 8 from that attack roll. If it would still... Let me know if it would still...
A 12 would... What's the AC on that snake there?
12.
So, yep, so that would have hit.
No, it says here attack 16 at Winston. So that would be an 8 on the attack.
Yep, that's true. Math is hard. You gotta give me a break here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's hard for all of us. It's all good.
What the hell? I'm totally goofing this up here. Hang on.
It's because it got absorbed by temporary hit points.
This is totally screwing it up. All right, so let's see here.
Winston's dead.
That's Winston's right. Dead,
you,
everyone.
You owe me some hit points now.
Like, the numbers on the combat checker changed so many times.
That's what we're going to go with. I think that's right.
I don't even know.
Close enough for government work. All right,
if I die, I'm just going to have an asterisk next to it. That's all I'm going to say.
All right, Ishii, you're up.
All right, let's see if we can finish up the wyvern here.
Don't forget, you got an extra attack.
I know. Right. I'm excited because...
I better hear some kiyas. I've waited a month.
I'm going to use Action Surge. And I believe Fighting Spirit... I get advantage on all my attack rolls. Why would I not use it? Alright. Meh. So I have 4 total attacks, I think. Action Surge, Haste, Extra Attack, and Regular Attack.
So Haste just means you get to go again, I believe. Hang on, you get your regular action.
It gives you an extra action that you can use for attack, disengage, or stride, or whatever it is.
Yep, that's right. So 4 attacks.
Oh boy, oh boy. Look at all of this.
Killed the dragon.
Oh, good lord.
I got a crit on the dragon.
You did.
You sure did.
And no Kia.
Sorry, I'm just so excited to see this damage. Kia! Kia, 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 Kia.
This is Ishii's version of casting a fireball.
Oh, yeah.
I was picturing Trinity. Also... I was picturing Trinity from The Matrix just going apeshit on everyone.
It's also my version of casting a fireball. I cast a 3rd level spell and make somebody else do fireball damage.
These guys are pretty hardy, too, man.
Okay. Kegers.
Throw up the 10-foot thing around my character.
Alright, for some spiritual guardians.
Yep. And then I'm going to move to right here.
Alright.
So, let's see here. It would hit not all of them, right? Berserker 12 is just outside the radius.
Yeah, it wouldn't hit 12. It would. But everybody else it would get. They better enjoy Harshnag while they can, though. Little do they know. I don't want to give away any spoilers in case they end up going back and listening to this, because they can't hear me right now.
I thought there was something that I could do as an instant. But, all right, we'll call that good.
All right, Ishii, you are up. Let me get rid of your fighting spirit. All right, continue on.
Alrighty. Let's Kia this guy.
So in case nobody's picked up on it yet, I actually re-roll initiative every round. I feel like that kind of gives
you used up all your fighting spirit, Ishii.
More dangerous.
And I got to go first. What the
fuck? Sometimes can be a little.
So did I still have haste?
Haste.
Let's pretend I didn't hit the next.
It doesn't allow the players to
Kia. God. Look at the
ouch
combat tracker and predict. Hey, I see this person.
So I just hurt you going around with this big massive sword like a blender the first time, and then now it's just like dragging around the ground. You're going, damn, this bitch got heavy.
This does not represent my fighting style.
I imagine it as her hearing me say that she reminded me of Trinity from The Matrix, and then she blushed and got embarrassed and just like fell on her face.
Yeah, pretty much.
Trying to do some Matrix leak shit.
Alright, so Wendell, you approach the Berserker, stab and miss. Do you land with the second one? Dropping him to the ground.
Yay.
Yeah, that's what I love about Fantasy Grounds is that it's so easy just to re-roll it. If in person, I wouldn't do this at all, because that would be a big pain in the ass re-rolling initiative every round. Right, Winston.
Hey!
Yeah!
Alright, Raylan.
Alright. Forgot to put that up at the beginning of combat, sorry about that. There's not too much more that I can aid in this combat with, so I'm just gonna point to the worm blood, let me see, am I within range? Hang on. Yes, I am. And I'm gonna kind of pull the horn from my lips and say, I don't need this anymore. You're all absolute clods when it comes to combat. How could you think that attacking us head on was a good idea when you let our strongest ally get behind you and flank you? And I'm gonna cast Vicious Mockery.
Alright. Let's see if that hurts their feelings. It does not. They shrug your words off.
And that's it for me.
Alright. Zerker 12 here is going to continue its assault on the giant snake and miss. This Berserker here is going to keep its assault on Ishii and miss.
Wait a minute. Which one was that one?
13.
So on his, at the beginning of his roll, he takes whatever damage from mine or whatever.
All right, go ahead and throw it on him. All right. Our snag is going to reach out and touch someone. Swings his axe. Hits. Killing this person. And then turns and heads back towards the door. And throws a shoulder into it. Alright, Keggers.
Ishii, how you holding up? Do you need healing or you want me to go ahead and try to finish this guy off?
Finish it.
Finish him.
Healing is for the weak.
I disagree. Healing is for the me. You know, the guy sitting on 18 hit points.
You got plenty of health left.
Alright, I'm going to raise my Warhammer and call out to Morden and aim at Berserker 13.
Question where a bad roll by the fist. Interesting. That's actually kind of neat.
I'm like ready for this big hit and then I see you hit it and it makes like a squeaky toy sound. And my face is like, oh.
Squeak, squeak. Seemed really locked. Anyway, we'll see. That was my attack. All right, I got nothing else.
You don't do any spiritual guardian weapon damage?
I do, but it's first thing or whatever on the turn,
Peppers,
whatever
it's to them. So your turn again.
Yep. So that would do the damage to this guy again. Because it's either their first turn or the start of my turn, either one. So,
yeah, I like that. It would give everybody, I don't want to say an automatically equal so chance to go, but it would give everybody a chance to.
And then because of that, the use Prayer of Healing.
Before you do that, why don't we just say that you're probably going to kill that berserker since he goes last.
Okay. Yeah, I'll just hold my action then.
All right. So right as the last one falls, you hear a loud thud as the doors finally break free from their icy hold and swing open.
Well, what do you know? It was like magic. We just kill all the invaders and it's like a blood sacrifice.
And I'm going to guess that we're going to get a cliffhanger.
All right, so as a cliffhanger, still got a question. I got a question before we move. Anything.
Not a cliffhanger, by the way. We're still going.
Seeing how we just finished up combat, he's at the door, but he's got it pushed open. Two questions. One, can he see anything on the inside? And two, do we have any ability to heal anybody right here without casting spells?
Anything like that. Not unless you rest. And from where y'all are at down the stairs, you cannot see anything other than just the doors are open.
All right, so I will hold on before anybody goes anywhere. I'm guessing that Winston's going to go back to his regular form or whatever.
Yeah.
So, who all needs healing? Everybody
raises his hand.
All right. So, up to six creatures that I can see within range. And Wendell, I'm assuming before you moved off, I would have healed you. So I'm not going to pump that up. Damn good roll.
It was almost maxed healing there.
It was almost maxed healing. Thank you, Morden. And I used a second level spell. Alright, I'm done.
That puts me pretty dang close to full. Very nicely done.
Does everybody want to move up to see what you see?
Ishii's still pretty wounded, but...
Yeah. Ishii, you want me to...
I'm okay.
I was going to say, I can do more, but it burns up spells.
No. 22 is fine. Besides, like, if I get knocked unconscious, I get to roll three times, and maybe I'll see Grundar today. I don't know.
Holy shit. I just realized that was a level one spell I cast, not a level two.
Oh, wow. That's a level one spell? Dang.
So Harshnag walks in. Do y'all follow?
Carefully move towards the back.
Are these all giants?
Thick frost clings to every surface of this 100-foot-high vaulted chamber. Seven enormous statues dominate the room. The largest of them is an 80-foot-tall robed giant, his arms outstretched and his face hidden beneath a stony cowl, facing a glowing archway in the east wall. Kneeling in rows to each side of the statue are six statues half its size, each impressive in its own right and depicting a paragon of a type of giant, hill, stone, frost, fire, cloud, and storm. These smaller statues face the bigger one in the room's center. In their outstretched arms, five of the giants hold weapon gifts for their all-father. Only the frost giant statue is unarmed. The archway is 40 feet wide and 40 foot tall. Six different runes are carved into it, each one inlaid with mithril, and a glowing mist fills the arch. Niches in the walls of either side of it contain empty, ice-covered sconces made of iron.
Wow.
Fancy.
So you said the frost giant was the only one that wasn't armed?
That is correct.
Taking a look at the statue from here, does it look like the statue was once armed?
Yes, yeah, looking, give me an investigation check. Wendell, you as well. So, Raylan, you get the feeling that this, just seeing from the couple days or the days that you spent with Harshnag and just the weapon that he wields, it looks like more than likely an axe would normally be in his hands. Wendell, other than the pretty colors, you have no idea what the hell you're looking at.
Is there anything in the ground that would possibly resemble that axe?
There is not.
I kind of look over at Harshnag and say, how frozen shut was that door? And how long has this place been vandalized?
He says, well, the door was frozen solid with ice on this side, so I would say that it has been frozen for quite some time.
You have any idea what might have had the gall to come in here and steal the steal or break the statue in some manner to remove the frost giant's axe?
I do not believe that the giant was vandalized. I do believe that somebody has wandered off with the axe, but I would suspect that... I mean,
that counts as vandalism, but all right.
I suspect that, knowing what I know of this temple, the axe is somewhere within.
Great. Now I'm more worried about this.
Pretty.
I don't suppose you can tell us any more about what's up with this archway.
Why, yes, I can. And he walks towards the archway and motions for y'all to follow. Watch this chat. They're not gonna see this coming. Are Winston and Ishii, are y'all staying back there?
I mean,
I don't know.
Yeah, I'll follow.
Alright.
Can we just walk under the statue, I guess?
That one you can just do that. So he walks and points to the runes and said, these are things that you will have to wait till next week to find out.
So you lied nice. To us.
It is a cliffhanger, god dang it.
So everybody earned a level.
Woo!
Yeah.
Which should bring you up to level 7. I always try to cliffhang them at the end of the night. I've been pretty good at doing it so far. You got to keep them coming back wanting more. So we can, I'll go ahead and leave the server up. So y'all can do that. And Raylan, go ahead and do that as well, and we'll chat some more and whatnot.
Yep.
Right, you gotta.
Sounds good to me.
Our previous session a month ago, if you go back and watch it, it ended on a very sad note. Oh man, it was sad. I almost got a little teary-eyed. It was sad. But yeah. You do the same. Definitely check back in. Trying to get a Sunday game going. Just pop into Discord and chat if you want to in one of the channels or something.
Alright, so we're done for the night?
Yep. Yeah, we're done.
Alright.
So yeah, I appreciate everybody stopping in. If you haven't done so already,
peace out, Wendell.
Give us a follow on the channel. Like us on Facebook. Subscribe on the YouTube. Check out my Instagram. I post whenever I run games in person, I always try to take pictures and stuff like that. We got a podcast, all that kind of good stuff. Yeah. So we will definitely be back next Friday, 6:30 p.m. Central Standard Time when we start. As long as I don't get picked for jury duty and it runs all night. I hope it doesn't. Then we'll be streaming some Lord of the Rings. We'll be streaming some Lord of the Rings through the week. Yeah, Estrada. So the podcast has got all of our... It's got our Friday's games. It's got our Sunday games that we ran for a while. It's got a special edition QuestCon game. I mean, there is hours and hours and hours and hours. Tons and tons of content there. It's got our full Curse of Strahd campaign. It's got our Dragon Heist campaign. Storm King's Thunder campaign to date. Some Shadow of the Demon Lord stuff. Some Satanic Panic stuff. All sorts of good stuff. Let me throw out some links to the podcast. Yeah, there we go. But all right, so yeah, I'm gonna take off for the evening, and we will definitely see y'all back Friday at the latest. Y'all have a good night. Gwydion, thanks for the cheer. Y'all should check out Gwydion's stream as well. He's a fellow streamer. We'll see everybody later. Night.